Welcome to week 8. I'm so glad that you're with us. This study on the Sermon on the Mount. What a rich, rich study this has been and is going to continue to be. We're going to go for our second look at Blessed are the pure in spirit, for they will see God. You know, as I mentioned last week, and if you haven't seen the previous videos on this, go back. This is our 8th week. You really want to pick up week 1 and just walk forward with us. They're not that long, 30, 35 minutes. They're rich. And it's not rich because I'm teaching. It's rich. And I mean this with all my heart, because the Holy Spirit is just downloading and downloading and downloading all of this clarity and all this energy and all this creativity, all in ways that we can look at the Sermon on the Mount, and specifically right now, the Beatitudes, with a fresh look in a way that I haven't seen before. And I really have to confess, I haven't spent a lot of time studying the Beatitudes. I have the Sermon on the Mount, the rest of it, but not the Beatitudes. I just kind of roll through them. I'm not a big Proverbs guy. I'm not a big Psalms guy, although there are isolated Psalms that I love and there are isolated Proverbs that I love. I'm not a poetry guy, so I just don't spend a lot of time just reading through the Psalms or reading through Proverbs. So I hit something like Beatitudes and I go, okay, that's nice. Let's get to the meat of it. And that's a mistake, because there's a lot of meat in the Beatitudes. We've walked our way slowly, 7 weeks now, the 8th week on, and we're getting the pure in spirit. How in the world could we take this long just to get to this Beatitude when some folks will go through the Sermon on the Mount study in 2 or 3 weeks? It's going to take us a year. And as you recall last week, I said, I really thought that the pure in spirit part of it, blessed is the pure in spirit, that we'd kind of roll through that, because I didn't have anything on it, really. I'm not pure in spirit, and my inclination was I don't have a lot to talk about, and I don't know really that much about it. So let's move on to Blessed are the Peacemakers, because I feel like I'm loaded up for that. But the Holy Spirit said, no, we can't do both of those in one day. As a matter of fact, as I went on and started digging into it, and the Holy Spirit started downloading like emails, boom, 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 idea after idea after idea, clarity after clarity after clarity, I realized we'd have to take 2 weeks on the pure in spirit. And now I realize it's going to take 3 weeks. And I think part of my motivation, or probably, let's say more accurately, the Holy Spirit's motivation, is that look at the promise, blessed are the pure in spirit, for they will see God. And we fleshed that out a good bit last week, but I just want you to pause for a moment and think about that startling statement, that monumental declaration, that incredible promise, for they will see God. What does that mean? And what would it mean in your life to see God? Now, let's just say the more pure our heart is, the more pure our spirit is, the more we will see God. So this is a process for us. No one is going to snap their fingers and have a pure heart tomorrow. And as a matter of fact, none of us will have a perfectly pure heart on this side of humanity, but we can grow and we can gain impurity by purging out the things that are in our heart that are impure. And the promise is the more we do that, the more we will see God. In John 14:21, Jesus says, if you have my commands and you obey them, that shows me that you love me. Not that you have my commands as rules and you obey them as some type of plea, but in the military. No, you see my teachings and you want to live by them. And yes, you obey them in that sense, but you live them out. By doing that, you're showing that you love me. He says, and my Father will love you, and I too will love you, and I will show myself to you. And my friends, we cannot blow by that quickly. That promise from Jesus and this promise in the Beatitudes from Jesus, it's just incredible. So what would that mean to see God, or for Jesus to be showing himself to you? And in our previous lessons, we talked about Tony Evans says, if all you can see is what you see, then you're not seeing all there is to see. If all you can see is what you see, then you're not seeing all there is to see. If all I can see is what I see with these eyes of mine, these human limited eyes of mine, then I am nowhere close to seeing all there is to see. And then another quotation, and I do not know who said it, so I'm not taking credit for it. We don't see things as they are, we see things as we are. See, this promise that they will, that we will see God, that Jesus will show himself to us. We don't see things as they are. We see things as we are. My dear friend, Matt, down in Charleston, who's from Napa, I call him Napa Matt. We were walking on the Battery headed to the Bible study Friday morning, last Friday morning. It was 6 o'clock. It was dark, but the stars were up and the sun was on the horizon coming up over the harbor in Charleston. It was absolutely beautiful. And we stopped and he pulled out his phone. And I'd seen him do this before, but this time I paid attention. And he pulled up an app, Skyview Light, L-I-T-E, Skyview Light app. And with it, he holds it up and he can see what all the stars are that we cannot see as we stand there. And it also puts the constellations on there and it shows the planets. And it's fascinating. So he's looking for where the sun is going to come up on the horizon. And it, boom, there it is. That's where the sun's going to be. He can put it down and point it towards the ground and we can see what's on the other side of the globe. It's fascinating what's there, but we cannot see it. And I remember experiencing living in Sumter or being at college or living in Atlanta and then getting out into the open and a gazillion stars that I couldn't see inside the towns or the cities. And they call that white pollution, light pollution, light pollution. It's just blocking out that incredible brilliance and the thousands and thousands, millions and millions of stars. It's blocking it out. They're there. And those constellations are there and those planets are there, but I cannot see them with my naked eye. I need now the help of that app. It's that way with us when it comes to seeing life, seeing this world. My heart's impure. It's like the light pollution. It's like the noise all around me. I cannot see it because of the impurity of my heart. I think about what it would be like to see with the eyes of God, to see God, and I think implied in that would be to see with his eyes. And for Jesus to show himself to me, and implied in that would be to see through Jesus's eyes. And I'll just take two political figures we can all hate, one or the other, or both. I disdain both of them, quite frankly. Nancy Pelosi and Mitch McConnell, both of them are evil as they can be, and they are. One's on the Democrat, one's on the Republican, so I'm not taking political sides. But I think Jesus would look at Nancy Pelosi and see this hurting, broken girl inside. And I think he would look at Mitch McConnell and he would see this broken, hurting little boy inside, who's both of them just so desperate to be successful and to have their way. And he would see the brokenness inside of them. I want to see with those eyes. To see God, for Jesus to show himself to me, if that's the promise, then I want to know what this pure in heart thing is all about. And I want my heart to become more and more pure. You know, sometimes I'll be with Dina and she'll say, did you see the pelicans? Because we love pelicans. Because, you know, they typically fly in formation and they can take these big swoops with their wings and just glide. And sometimes they'll glide right on down to the surface of the water and they'll be what looks like 6 or 8 inches off the water and they're just gliding along. She said, did you see that? And I said, no, I missed it. Or I might say, did you see those clouds? Or did you see that sunset or that sunrise? And whoever, Dina or whoever might say, no, I missed that. I want to say, and Dina wants to say to me, look, open your eyes, see what's there. I think about people with high EQ. You know, IQ is your intellectual quotient. EQ is your emotional quotient. And people that have that high emotional quotient, they see what's going on behind the eyes and in the facial expressions of people. You know, you catch that facial expression, that quick glimmer of pain, that quick glimmer of fear. You see it in their eyes. Maybe the next person next to you doesn't see it, but if you have a high EQ, you can see and sense what's going on. You have different eyes. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. That's what we want. So last week, let me just pull up our screen share. And we've covered these first two. Last week, we talked about the promise, the problem, your position, and your power source. The promise is we'll see God. We've covered that. The problem is, and it's a big old problem, is your heart and my heart, impure, divided, impure. And it is a huge problem. And remember, everything we're talking about, being more and more pure in heart, purifying our heart, this is always going to be a process, a day-by-day, step-by-step process. So no one should get discouraged. No one should say, well, I'll never conquer this, because it is such a process. But we want to be on that process. We do not want to be lazy about this, because the promise, if it's important to you, you'll make it happen. If it's not, you'll make excuses. Is it important to you to see God, to have Jesus show himself to you? If not, then you are missing it, my friend, because it's the most incredible promise we can find in the scripture, short of everlasting life, or maybe the power of the Holy Spirit. I want it, and I want you to want it. So the big problem is a big old divided and impure heart. You have it, I have it. Some people have it a lot worse. I'll probably have it worse than you do. Some people have it less, but we all have it. But even though it's a big problem, your position. In Hebrews 10:14, we looked at several passages last week that say that your position in Christ, your position in Jesus, is holy and blameless, without blemish, free from accusation. That's Colossians 1. Holy and blameless, without blemish, free from accusation. Can you imagine that? But it's true. It's a fact. Hebrews 10:14, for by one sacrifice he made perfect forever those who are being made holy. For by one sacrifice, Jesus made perfect forever, made you perfect forever. But also the process is, as you are being made holy, as you are being set apart, as you are becoming a different person, a person with a more pure heart, that is the process captured. So the position is, we're dealing from a position of strength, not weakness. That big old mountain of your bad heart, you're already on the top of the mountain. You can conquer this little by little, bit by bit, day by day. And the way the Holy Spirit works is, it may seem little by little and day by day and bit by bit, but then there come these huge chunks and you have these bumps in your trajectory. I am trying to cheerlead you in one way, but I'm also trying to get you to see what's there for you, the promises. And then finally, last week, we talked about your power source, because you will never do this on your own. You must learn to lean into and lean onto the power of the Holy Spirit. And if that's a foreign concept to you, which I'm sure it is for most of you, leaning into and leaning on just means seek him, talk to him, ask for his involvement, ask for his Holy Spirit power, what we call energy, clarity, and creativity. Ask for him to give you that Holy Spirit power, that energy, that clarity, that creativity. And then because he's real, he'll do that. And you'll see it happening. I got a new passage for you for this week, 2 Corinthians 7:1. Therefore, since we have these promises, dear friends, let us purify ourselves from everything that contaminates body and spirit. We have these promises, the promises we talked about. Let us purify ourselves from everything that contaminates body and spirit, perfecting holiness. And I put in parentheses, perfecting me in this sense, meaning maturing to holiness, maturing to being set apart, to being different, to being conformed to the likeness of Jesus, out of reverence for God. That's our motivation. Not really, the motivation is not really that we can see God, although that is part of my, large part of mine, that Jesus will show himself to me, but I'm doing this out of reverence for God. I want to have a more pure heart. I don't want this stuff inside my heart. We're going to break down all these different things, everything that contaminates body and spirit. We'll come to that in a moment. Today, we're going to look at purging and pouring into. We won't have time to get to protective practice. We'll do that next week, but purging and pouring into. Pure in the Hebrew is bara lava, and it means cleanse or rejuvenate. So in the cleansing part, we're talking about purging those things in our heart that we don't want anymore. Getting them out, ruthlessly purging them. And then the rejuvenating is the pouring back into. Doesn't that work well? See, that's not Sam coming up with that. That's the Holy Spirit. I didn't have any of this before we started studying this and talking about it. This is all Holy Spirit driven. So today, ruthlessly purge whatever takes you out of the flow of the kingdom among us, that river of life flowing through the kingdom that Jesus said, I brought it to you now, live in the kingdom now. Whatever it is, it takes me out of the flow. I got to get that out of my heart. Now look at this passage from David in Psalm 139, 23 through 24. And as we read it, I want you to think, who would ask God of this? Who would be so foolish, so stupid as to say, God, this is what I want you to do? Because my inclination is to say, don't do this. Do not do, leave me alone. I'm okay as I am. I'm okay as is. I don't need this kind of forensic investigation into my heart and my thoughts. But David, who was a man after God's own heart, he says this, search me, God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there's any offensive way in me and lead me in the way everlasting. He's inviting his heavenly Father to search him, to dig in forensically. Test, know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there's any offensive way in me, because I want you to lead me in the way everlasting. And I know you, I cannot get there with these other things. Who would ask that? You'd have to be nuts. I don't want to invite that kind of investigation into my heart. I don't want to see it. I want him to leave me alone. Who would ask this? Someone who wants it. Someone who wants to go deeper. I've been around athletes who would say, come on, coach, go harder. Push me harder. I want everything you've got for me. I don't want to leave any of my talent or my physical conditioning on the table. I want it all. Push me harder, coach. I think about back in, I think we were in the seventh grade, and we had this basketball coach as our history teacher. And he was not a history teacher. He was just doing this because he wanted to coach basketball. And it was pretty lame. It really was very lame. And we weren't learning anything. And we had a girl in the class, a good friend I'd grown up with, a Peg Cutno, who was tragically murdered not long after this. But Peg one day said to our teacher, you're not challenging us at all. We're not learning a thing in here. Well, it really angered the teacher. And he went down to Ms. Nunley, who really did teach history. And he started getting notes from her. And the class got harder and harder and harder. We were all going, Peg, what in the world? We had it easy in here. But Peg wanted to learn. I was in the seventh grade. All I cared about was girls and basketball. But Peg wanted to learn. So she challenged our teacher. Do you want it? Apparently King David wanted it. Do you want this enough to say, look, get inside of me. Show me what's in you. I want you to see it. I want you to show it to me in case I don't realize it's in there. And then let's purge it out. If it's important to you, you'll make it happen. If it's not, you'll make excuses. Hebrews 12, 1 through 2. And I want you to notice how similar this is to 2 Corinthians 7. Therefore, they both start with a therefore. Since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, 2 Corinthians 7, since we have these promises, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. Let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. So far, we are asking our Heavenly Father that we want to get out of our hearts and our impure hearts, everything that contaminates body and spirit, our anxious thoughts, any offensive way in me. And now we come to this and we see everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. That's what we're asking our Heavenly Father to do. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, Hebrews 12, 2. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. That word fix, it means literally to look away from anything that distracts. Look away from anything that might divide your thoughts. Fix your eyes on Jesus. Purge all this other stuff out. And then start to pour back in. Let's start with this first, 2 Corinthians 7, 1. Everything that contaminates body and spirit. My second year on the basketball team at Clemson, I got to be better friends with a player named Alan Hoover. He played baseball and basketball, and he was one of these real fitness nuts before anybody was typically a fitness nut. And I was standing beside him in the on the training table. It's just the football and the basketball team down there, and we're going through, and you can get whatever you want. It was incredible. It was great. Matter of fact, I was coming up from the training table one day, and this girl, some co-ed, I didn't know her, was coming out of the regular Schletter meal hall, I'm sure having endured yet another bland, awful meal. And I'm coming up out of the training table, and she comes through the door at the same time, and she looked at me and said, "You make me sick." And I said, "I know, I get it. I'm lucky as I can be." But I'm standing there, and I'm getting ready to put a Coke in my cup. And Alan, who's standing beside me, he looks at me and he goes, "Dirt in the carburetor. Dirt in the carburetor." He wasn't going to put that in him. It contaminated his body, and he wasn't going to put it in him. So I want you to think in terms of purifying that dirt in the carburetor. What is contaminating your body and your spirit? And let's say your mind, because that's what this meaning is in all of this, the body, mind, and spirit. And I want you to think in terms of what's sloppy and what's sinful. Because some things don't appear to be sinful, but they're sloppy and they're contaminating your body and your mind and spirit. Things you look at, things you eat, things you do, things you say, things you listen to, things you read. They're contaminating your body, mind, and spirit. Let us purify ourselves from everything. I want you to think in terms, and see, when I talk about these things, you know exactly what I'm talking about. For you. You know it. You don't have to sit there and think a long time. And if you were to say, "Well, I think I'll call Sam and ask him if this is one of those things," then you know what the answer is. Or else you wouldn't call me. And all of these things, anxious thoughts, offensive ways, anything that hinders, the sin that so easily entangles, you know exactly what the Lord is talking about to you right now. You sense it in your spirit. Yeah, he's talking about that one thing. Dadgum it. I keep feeling it. I keep feeling that conviction. I just can't get rid of it. I know what he's talking about. Or you like King David and you want it so badly that you'll say, "Okay, I know it's not going to be easy, but I'm going to purge my heart of these things. I know they've been with me a long time. I know it seems like they're part of me. They're part of my genetic makeup." They are not. It's going to be really hard, but and when I hear this, that it's, you know, being a Christian's hard or doing this kind of thing, going deeper and deeper into the kingdom, purifying ourselves, pouring back into, that's hard. I think in terms of being a father, and if any child of mine, if Britton called and said, "Dad, I'm in trouble," or if my wife Dina called and said, "I'm in trouble," or my sister's called and said, "I'm in trouble, and I need you to come," and they're 50 miles away, and I don't have a car, and I don't have access to a car, it's going to be hard to get there. But does that even factor into the equation? It's hard. It's hard is irrelevant when it's that important to me. Yeah, I'm going to get there, whatever it takes. It takes me running 50 miles. I'm going to get there because it's that important to me. Hard is irrelevant. So, everything that contaminates body and spirit, whatever you're putting in there that's dirt in the carburetor, you don't want that. Let's purify that out. Anxious thoughts. Now, you look at David is saying, "I want you to get inside of me." So when we think about anxious thoughts in any offensive way, we're talking about what's going on inside of us. These aren't really active sins, action sins. These are things going on inside. Anxious thoughts. Are anxious thoughts a sin? Is worrying a sin? Well, first off, Jesus tells us not to. So if we're doing something he tells us not to, that sounds a lot like a sin. But in Romans, we see that everything that, Romans 14, that everything that does not come from faith is sin. So here we are, losing our faith, not trusting, having these anxious thoughts. These thoughts of, if I don't, it won't, if it's to be, it's up to me, or how will I, or what if, all these anxious thoughts, all we're saying is, "I don't trust you, Jesus. I don't believe your promises that our Heavenly Father will take care of me. I'm just saying I don't trust you." That's an insult on top of a sin. What are those anxious thoughts inside of you? You have them. We all have them. Let's start purging those and replacing those with trust. I know you're going to take care of me. I know you're involved in this situation. I know you're going to bring good out of it, whatever that's going to look like. I know these things. They're facts, not feelings. Any offensive way in me. See, there are things inside my heart, inside my head, that are offensive to my Heavenly Father. They may not be as offensive to him as what's going on in your heart. I've been walking with him 25 years. I've been doing 721 ministries for 17 and doing a lot of other things for 20 something. He's going to hold me to a high standard. He expects me to start living this life to the full, to have that love, joy, peace, patience. Any offensive way in me, he wants it out, and I want it out. Think about that. Any offensive way in me. How about if you have pride, which leads to judgment, which is a superiority over others? Or offensive way in you, you've got a Matthew 6, 22, you have, and 2 through 23, you have, instead of generous eyes, you have bad eyes, you have suspicious eyes. That's another part of the Sermon on the Mount. What offensive way, what's going on inside of me that I know he does, that's offensive to my Heavenly Father? And now we come to Hebrews 12, 1. Everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. What's hindering you? What's holding you back? What is it that's, you know, is it biases? Is it prejudices? Is it things like TV? And particularly news on TV, which these days on whichever side of the aisle you're on is all set up just to get you so angry you're about to explode. What's hindering you from that life in the flow? Whatever it is, it's hindering you from that life in the flow. It may be your cell phone. Get a hold of that thing. Get a grip on it. You manage it. Don't let it manage you. What is it that's hindering you, that's holding you back? Think of a weight or a ball and chain that's just holding you back from going deeper into the kingdom, from purifying your heart. And then the sin that so easily entangles. We all have sin in our hearts. Some of you look at porn. Some of you look at heavy porn. That's got to go. Some of you look at light porn. That would be magazines or movies where you know there's going to be some sex scenes in it. That kind of sin's got to go. Some of you have addictions, and they may not look like addictions to the outside world because you manage them real well, but you have addictions. You have sinful things going on in your life. Maybe you're cheating on your taxes. Maybe you're fudging things. You got great excuses for it, great rationalizations, but got to get rid of that sin. Now, I want to make an overarching observation. As we start to purify our hearts and replace, which we're going to talk about as we finish up, replace it with things that are more pure, these more pure are going to seem bland and boring at first. I think about watching Hallmark movies versus a movie that I know is going to have a lot of shoot 'em up, a couple of sex scenes, a lot of suspense. And that's the Hallmark movies are so predictable and boring. Gosh, they're so much more pure than what I typically tend to look at. Books. I know certain authors are going to, they're always going to put a sex scene in there, several sex scenes in there, and the others aren't going to bother with that, and I'm going to still get the good suspense, but I'm not going to have all that going on. Some are more violent than others. I mean, there's one author, I cannot read him. He's just too violent. I don't need to hear the description of somebody's head being cut off. So it's going to seem more bland and boring at first. I think about going from butter popcorn to popcorn, or going from sweet tea to just tea, and then from tea to water, or from full-on cola drink to a diet cola, and then to just water. Everything seems more bland and boring at first. But when you get there and get that other out of your system, you wouldn't go back. That's dirt in the carburetor. Red meat over fish. A black bean burger over a good old cheeseburger. I still eat good old cheeseburger, but I do eat a lot more fish than I do red meat. Less salty. All these things seem bland and boring, but once you get them out of your system, you don't want to put them back in because now you realize what kind of how they're contaminating your system. Now, there's one exception to this. That's baked potato chips. We cannot eat baked potato chips. We have to go with the real potato chips. The more pure baked potato chips, forget it. They're awful. Stay with the regular potato chips, but everything else, purify your heart and mind. If it's important to you, you'll do this. And I want you to see that it should be. It must be important to you. The promise is too huge. And remember again, it is a process. It's a day by day, one at a time process with the power of the Holy Spirit, leaning into Him and leaning on Him to carry you as you move forward. Now, finally, as we purge our hearts, we have to pour back in. Pour back into your heart whatever keeps you in the flow. The warning is this, Matthew 12:43. This is Jesus' words. When an impure spirit comes out of a person, it goes through arid places seeking rest and does not find it. Then it says, I will return to the house I left. When it arrives, it finds the house unoccupied, swept clean, and put in order. Now, in modern day terms, this is someone who starts purging their heart, getting the bad stuff out. Maybe you drink too much. Maybe you smoke too much. Maybe you look at things you shouldn't look at, and you start getting all that stuff out, but you're not filling up with the Holy Spirit, with the love, joy, peace, patience. You're just cleaning out. And that, my friends, is a very dangerous position because Jesus says, then it goes and takes with it seven other spirits, more wicked than itself, and they go in and live there. And the final condition of that person is worse than it was to start. We cannot just purge. We must pour back in anything and everything that keeps us in the flow. We have a couple of suggestions here. Ephesians 5:18, all from your Heavenly Father through the Holy Spirit. Do not get drunk on wine, which leads to debauchery. Instead, be filled with the Spirit. Filled with the Spirit. When I was being discipled by James Orders, he said, Sam, do you know what it feels like to be drunk on wine? And I said, well, sadly, yes, I do, too many times. And then he said, well, here's what I want you to think about. Who's in control when you're drunk on wine? The alcohol. But when you fill up the Holy Spirit, now the Holy Spirit is in control. Let's purge the other and fill up with the Holy Spirit. Speaking to one another with psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit. Sing and make music from your hearts to the Lord. Always giving thanks to God the Father for everything in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Well, speaking to one another with psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit. Sing and make music from your heart to the Lord. That sounds boring at first. Is so much better than what we typically have going on. And then Philippians 4:8-9, which is a very common, very well-known passage. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is not right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Last week, I asked the question, when your mind is idle, where does it go? And most of the men across the 721 meeting said, it goes out of the flow, not into the flow. When my mind is idle, let me do this. Let me think about whatever is true, noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, whatever is excellent or praiseworthy. Let me fill my mind and my heart with those kinds of things. It's going to take practice. It's going to be a process, but it's so much richer. It's such a more pure way to live. Whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put it into practice and the God of peace will be with you. We've covered purging and pouring into because the promise is so big and the problem is so big, but we're dealing from a position of strength with the power source of the Holy Spirit. I want you and I want me to be purging the things out of my heart and then pouring back in the things that are noble and sweet and wonderful and pure. Because I want to see God, and I want Jesus to show himself to me, and I want that for you, and I want you to want that. We'll be off next week, out of town, back the following week. Thank you for being with us. Take this into your heart. Lean into the power of the Holy Spirit. Dig and dig and dig and go deeper and deeper and deeper, and grace and peace be with you.